call to order the August meeting of the Finance Committee. We have two sections to the agenda, the general and the consent. We will take the consent first. Are there any items that anyone would like pulled? And Ms. Adams, I know you took a phone, just took a phone call from Mr. Montgomery, who is on the way but is running a little late. Which ones?
C2, C4, 5, and 11.
All right. Do you have any that you would like pulled?
No, I'm good.
Okay, Ms. Burke, do you have any? Anyone else? I'm going to add C13 for me. So that's 1, 2, 3, that's 5 different items. Do I have a motion to approve the balance?
Move for approval of the balance of consent item.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the balance of consent. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. So we will, if I may suggest, we'll do 13 first.
Yeah.
And then we will go to the general until Mr. Montgomery gets here, and then we'll take care of his consent items at that time.
Very good.
So anyway, C13, please.
Information on request for assistance for the Pepper Building located in the Northwest Ward.
Mr. Brooks, you're...
And I'll actually start.
All right. Why don't you give us a two-minute, and then I know this is just informational at this point, so if you'll just give us a two-minute explanation, please.
And you're correct, Chairman Clark. This is for informational purposes only. Assuming council for the Finance Committee supports this concept, it will be coming back in September for further consideration. But at this point, we've received a request from Cole Pepper LLC to redevelop the Pepper Building, which is located at the corner of Fourth and Liberty Streets. They are converting the old Pepper Building into a mixed-use structure involving both retail, restaurant, and some tavern-type space on the lower two floors. And then on the upper floors would be 54 residential units. These units would range from about 310 to 786 square feet. The monthly rents would range from $675 to $1,218. Mike Coe is here today, and the developers, his team has requested assistance from the city per the new workforce development guidelines that you'll be considering in about five minutes or so.
Okay.
But under those guidelines, it's recommended that at least 10% of the units would be made available for workforce units. And in this case, the developer has agreed that 11% or 6 of the 54 units would be available for workforce units, and those units would have a rent of $575 per month. Total project cost is a little bit over $8 million. On our typical guidelines, we never exceed more than 20% total project cost, so they're requesting funding of $1.6 million. If there's something that the committee supports, we'd bring it back next month. Looking at GO bonds as being the funding source, would be a long-term, low-interest loan that would be provided to the project. Happy to answer any questions you may have.
Okay.
Yes.
Ms. Burke has a question.
I'll be one of the first ones to say how much I appreciate what Mr. Coe has done in developing the downtown area. Every time I think of the downtown area, I always say bittersweet, because early on when we were doing all that development down there, we removed a lot of folks who also would like to have had some assistance. And there were small minority business people who had struggled down in the area. And to me, I look at the area, fine, we're making progress. This has nothing to do with Mr. Coe and what I'm saying, and I hope he understands this. I want to get, before I'm going to act on this, I would like to get all of the involvement that Mr. Coe has had downtown. And if we've given him any kind of assistance, I would like to know how much we have given him. And I commend him for wanting to help the people who cannot afford to live downtown if we're going to have more of a diversity. And when I say diversity, I'm talking about county incomes people get on their salaries in order to live downtown. I look right at Mr. Coe when I say, I thank you for what you're doing, Mr. Coe. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions for anyone at the table? I'll start with Mr. Bessie, and we'll go around the table.
Really just a clarification to make sure I understand. The proposal we can't just put on the table in a subsequent meeting is $1.3 million assistance, which would leverage six workforce housing units that we've rented for $575 million.
That's correct. $1.6 million.
$1.6 million.
$1.6.
$1.6 million, six units, $575 million.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. McIntosh, you had your hand up.
What position would we be in on that loan?
We'd be in a subordinated position, second position, borderline.
Okay, and the amortization schedule on the?
We've not worked out the terms yet, but it would probably be 20 to 25 years.
Okay, and I guess one thing I'd like to see is a pretty firm commitment on start and finish dates on the project.
Okay. And understand, this is just for informational today. We're not, right. Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I agree with Councilmember Burke that Mr. Coe has done a lot of projects in the downtown area without any assistance. And I recall, I'll double check that, Mr. Burke, when you get that information. I don't believe we've given him any assistance. So he's coming to help with this. And this is a pivotal project right there at the corner of 4th and Trade Street. And I know that the provision of the workforce housing units or something, I think Councilmember Montgomery, not speaking for him, but I think he's very, very supportive of that concept for sure. So the fact that we're being put in 20% of the project is consistent with previous projects.
Mr. Mayor, I need to ask another question.
Go right here.
Indirectly, the information I received from the city manager concerning the council people Adams and then Montgomery with the public housing, didn't I read something not too long ago where they were talking about giving some credit toward the public housing?
Yes. Mr. Page, why don't you talk about the letter we received from Mr. Woods?
Oh. Councilman Burke, we've received a letter from the Housing Authority, Mr. Woods, and it's just a concept at this point and no more than a concept. And that's actually why we held this item this month instead of bringing it back in July to meet with him to learn more about his concept. He's still in the development or planning phases of it, but under his concept, they would make vouchers available to multifamily projects that were able to use some of their vouchers in exchange for them getting an ownership interest in the project, and at the same time, they would then have units available for affordable and or workforce housing. He's still talking to HUD and had some preliminary conversations, seems to be some support for doing it, but he's probably several months out, if not longer, before that can be actually implemented.
Mr. Chairman, I need that. Now, are we talking about housing he would be in, that you're talking about coming downtown as well?
Under the concept, it would be multifamily housing anywhere. It could be downtown, it could be west side, but his concept would be anywhere in the city.
Well, I think that's a good concept. I want to hear more about it because if it's in a way similar to what we're talking about, we do not have enough people with different incomes downtown. And it is not diverse enough. As many of our tax dollars and their tax dollars that we have spent, I feel it needs to show and mirror this community in a different way. So I'm looking forward to both of these projects to see how they're going to work. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. By the way, Mr. Montgomery, we did pull items 2, 4, 5, and 11, and we haven't gotten to them yet. So
all right.
Get to them. We're on C-13 right now. Ms. Light has a question.
I just wanted to echo the mayor's comments that, I mean, this is a historic building, and I think it's extraordinarily important that we save that building, and I thank Mr. Coe for taking it all.
Okay. Mr. Page, my comments or questions, and obviously you will take all these comments into consideration when you come back next month, is if this is $1.6 million of the GO bonds, how much money total was in that category, and how much, you know, then therefore what percent would this be, and what other projects are we anticipating using that pool of money for?
You want me to ask that now?
You can, but I'd want it in writing as well. You may certainly comment
okay.
on it now.
Yeah, we have, the total housing portion for the GO bonds was $6 million. Mm-hmm. This is actually the first project that we've looked at to utilize that funding source. But we're having conversations with others as projects come along, but this is actually the first one that we've said, hey, this may be a good fit for that. But we're having conversations with several other projects that might work sort of in the chute, but not as far along as this one.
Okay. Are those far enough along that you could, not today, but could say who they are? So I just want to be sure we don't, do we have enough money to spend appropriately for all the projects as they come?
Probably not far enough along to publicly say.
Okay.
I can talk to you later about what those are.
All right. Ms. Burke?
Mr. Chairman, remember when we were having the RUCA and some of the people we felt had not been made aware as much as they should, so we would hope this time that with this particular plan that they would follow through and we would get it out to all of them. So if they're interested in the same kind of project, that they would have the same type of following up what
okay.
you said.
All right. Mr. Montgomery.
This question, it may have been asked and answered, but in reference to one of the guidelines that are listed, well, not one of the guidelines, but one of the places there for them providing the workforce housing there, as this is a dialogue that's in advance of any approval of what we're considering in reference to that affordable housing ordinance piece, is there any time commitment on how long that may or may be in place? I know Ms. Cole has stated that they have that in place, but I know it's not in writing exactly what. Is there a duration on that or not?
It will follow the same guidelines, Councilman Montgomery, that are in the Workforce Housing Fund, which I think are 15, 20 years.
Okay.
So it follows the same guidelines.
Okay.
Okay. So I think you've heard some of the comments, and we'll flush all that out and have it at the next meeting. That'd be okay. We will now, that's no action item, it's just information. We'll now go to C2, please, if your secretary reads that.
Resolution authorizing an increase in the threshold at which the real estate administrator may lease property from third parties on behalf of the city of Winston-Salem.
Ms. Carmen, this has got your name on it. Can you just give us a 30-second introduction?
Sure. Currently, the real estate administrator has the authority to enter into lease with third parties up to a year for a lease amount not to exceed $500 per month. And so this would extend that lease amount not to exceed $2,000.
Okay. Mr. Montgomery, this is your item.
I have a couple questions on this, and one is particularly in this change, and I see it said that, you know, it'd be a change that administrative they can do this function, but sometimes it's these things are brought when there are items that are being dealt with or matters that are similar that making this change would allow them to continue or to deal with the situation that's at hand now. So my first question is there a particular lease that is looking to be entered into that is over the $500 amount, and it's a short-term lease like this that we're looking at right now, and is that one of the reasons that this is being brought now?
Yes, in part. Mel Sadler's department is currently under a lease with the Airport Commission, which really has expired, and instead of just continuing to pay the rent there under an expired lease, my recommendation is to go ahead and enter into a new lease, not to exceed a year. I think they're looking at alternative locations, and it's going to take a little while for them to find one. So I just didn't want to make payments on a lease that's expired. So that came based upon my recommendation. There may be others as well.
And then the second question is, how many times can they renew that lease? And so if it's a short-term lease and they enter to it for a year, can they continue to go back again and renew that? Is it single year that they can do that?
One year, no renewal.
Okay.
Okie dokie, Mr. McIntosh.
How often do we run into this? Is it a common occurrence?
No, it's not. It's pretty unusual.
Thank you.
Okay. Do I have a motion to send this forward?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, a second on C2. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. We will now go to C4, please.
Report on continuum of care grant process.
Mr. Brooks, if you'll give us a two-minute introduction, I'd appreciate it.
Good afternoon, Chairman, members of the Finance Committee, Mayor. Mm-hmm. This item is just to give you a brief update on that continuum of care process, continuum of grant care process, which we had reported back to you in April. Proposals were submitted and workshops were held, and we have a deadline. We have not yet gotten the notice of funding availability from HUD, so we're still waiting on that. And until that comes, there's really nothing we can do. We just wanted to update you to let you know that when that comes, and we expect it to come sometime between now and next month, it'll be a short turnaround period, we'll get you that information. The list of individuals who submitted proposals, we have attached it in all our renewal projects. But as of now, we can't do anything because we haven't gotten the notice of funding availability yet. So we just wanted to let you guys know that.
Are these the projects that several years ago we had the issue of having to, we had to kind of lend the money forward until the federal money came through?
Yes.
So there could be a gap. I'm just picking one example. Here's a Halls, a rental assistance for disabled homeless. If the federal money doesn't come through in time, we basically funded it until the federal money came in and reimbursed it.
That's what we did before, yes, sir.
All right. I think there were a few other questions or comments, Ms. Adams.
Yes, thank you. Do we think we might see that same situation again this year, next year, Mr. Brooks? No, it's kind of, but I don't think we, for me, I don't think we saw that one coming, did we not?
Didn't see that one coming. Don't know if it'll come this time. You just never know.
Okay. I guess my next question then is, again, all of the agencies that have submitted their proposals, and I see that they're reviewed by two councils, Homeless Council and the Continuum of Care Council. Does anybody ever get a survey from the customers of all of these services, and so that we can see, are the people happy? You know, the people that we're serving with this money, do they get a chance? And maybe they do. I don't know. But again, I'm always wondering, is everything as good as everybody says that it is?
To my knowledge, we have not conducted a survey, nor am I aware of the agencies conducting a survey. But if you would like for us to look into that, we certainly can do so.
I'd like for us to do that, Mr. Brooks. I think, again, that's a way that we are being proactive. We're the pass-through for the money, but we're ultimately held responsible for if any headlines, blasts come up, that there's been some issues going on that maybe we didn't check into, and we're the ones really will be held at fault for it. So I'd like to see staff or working with these two other organizations come up with some kind of way that we do a survey, just like they do the count every year. We got to figure out how we do a survey to account for those same customers that filter in through these programs in and out. I sure would appreciate it, and
we'll
I know the council
started
would.
And report back to you.
Thank you.
Ms. Light?
To comment on that, I do know that the Homeless Council is very pleased with the effect of the programs that they are doing now. And so hopefully the survey will back that up.
Okay. Our attorney wanted to ask them a comment here.
Yes, I know this is not an item for action today, but I would like for the record to reflect that Councilmember Montgomery did not participate in the discussion based on a conflict waiver.
Okay, thank you.
And also, Mr. Chairman, we have emphasized the way we do business. It's always creative to do it a little more, be more creative. We have to stop doing things the same way. You can go back and find that some folks are doing things the same way over these programs, some of them that they started when they first started on the job. And I've said to the city manager, you need to ask your staff to do things a little bit different. And I think the point you bring up is good. Even when we were working with the workforce, I think when the mayor was working, we had to ask people, talk directly to the people you serve, mm-hmm. not the people who work here. Naturally, I'm going to say it's good. But then who are you serving? What are they going to say? That's a good point. Thank you.
Okay. This is just for information, and I'm assuming, Mr. Brooks, you will push the HUD to get there. It's up to us.
As best we can.
As best you can push that rock. We'd appreciate it. Okay, C5.
Report on revisions to economic development program, financial assistance guidelines.
Mr. Page, your name's at the top. You want to give us an introduction?
Yeah. And this is Councilmember Burke's comments about being creative is a good segue into what we're trying to do here, because we are trying something that we don't think has been tried anywhere. But we wanted to see what you all think about this concept. every few years we do look at the economic development guidelines and make recommendations for revisions to those guidelines. Based on things that we've heard from you over the last couple of years, we're bringing new suggested recommendations to you. There are four key points of the revised recommendations. One of them is to reduce the amount of the minimum investment from $1.5 million to $1 million for existing businesses. We've had a couple projects over the last few years that weren't at the minimum threshold, but may have, if they were at the $1 million threshold, would have been able to qualify for some additional incentives. Reduce the minimum job creation from 20 to 15 created or retained jobs in 36 months. Again, that's for existing companies. Increase the average starting wage from $10 to $10.48 per hour, which is the current living wage for a single person living in Forsyth County. And then the big one is to provide a bonus incentive payment of $250 for each qualified employee hired and retained at least 6 months by the company. A qualified employee would be someone that lives within the NRSA or has employment barriers such as a criminal record. While we can't mandate or require them to hire certain people, we can provide incentive payments or additional bonus payments for them to hire these certain types of individuals that I hear council often saying they'd like us to find ways to get them to hire local employees or to look at hiring ex-felons. And this would be one of the ways is by adding a bonus incentive payment.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern.
Again, this is just for informational purposes. We'll bring it back later.
There are a couple points on this. One, I think, is good to kind of look at approaching this in a different way so that we're having a larger impact. I think that's something to look at. A couple questions I have, though. One is in reference to the actual number, minimum number of jobs in terms of the decrease. Is that associated with the investment? Is that the reasoning behind decreasing that number? Because there's a decrease in the minimum amount of investment, so therefore a decrease in the number of jobs?
Typically, we look at them separately, job and investment. The reason for the decrease in the jobs is because what we're seeing is smaller companies. A 15-person company or creating 15 jobs in today's environment is actually a large number of jobs being created. We just don't see the 20, 30 jobs being created by companies the way we were several years ago.
Okay, and then when we look at the actual the bonus incentive payment, couple pieces on that is interesting to me in terms of looking at, one, how incentivized am I for $250 for an employee? How much of an incentive is that to me in creating 15 jobs? To me, that doesn't seem to be that large of an incentive for me to hire those 15 individuals who have these type of barriers, because it may take me a little bit more work or I have to do something additional, and $250 doesn't seem to offset that balance. So a question would be, is there opportunity for that number to be different and higher? Are we bound by how much we can do for the incentive payment? And if we're not bound by that, in the actual dollar amount that we do for a total project, is there a way for us to decrease that or tie that actual incentive payment to what we do for the qualified employee so that it is much more pressure in terms of getting the larger amount that they want for the project, that they hire people that are within the city to do so that live within these bounds, if that made any sense to anybody. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'll answer the legal piece in terms of the authority for what we're doing in terms of the dollar amount. That's actually a question for Mr. Page. But the authority we're using, the statutory authority, is 168.456, which means that it has to be based upon the low to moderate income population that you're trying to serve. So that's why the language is basically tied to the neighborhood revitalization strategy area and those with those types of barriers. So we need to make sure that component remains because that's the statutory authority we're using. In terms of increasing the amount, there's no cap in the statute on the amount. It's just we need to make sure it's that population, that target population that we're providing the enhancement for.
And so what I'm getting at is that even with that piece on it, in terms of if we have a real desire to encourage companies and businesses to hire, particularly those who may need the jobs the most, what's a real incentive to do so? And $250 to me is not a very large incentive. So is there a way to pair that larger dollar amount in the sense of if they would normally qualify, let's say that they qualify for $500,000 of a local incentive based upon how it was currently structured, is there a way to structure those incentives where they don't normally qualify for 500, but under this they qualify for $300,000, and another portion of that is associated with $200,000 that's associated with the actual jobs, which makes it more incumbent upon them to hire those individuals because they actually get what they want for the project?
I think you can structure it that way. I guess it's just a question of whether or not the council wants to tie the funds up that way. And then you all decide that as a body. But I think you can structure
it. I'm saying if we want to be intentional, $250 is not very intentional.
Just to point out that in some of our economic development incentives, we actually do $500 per job created. So I wonder if, having this the same across the board would not be a good idea.
But this would be, Mr. Page, you don't have an actual example there, but what we're saying, if you meet these guidelines, we give you so much money per job or per investment.
Correct. And the 250 is just a number that I brought in. You all can change that. The
but it's, it would be in addition to the regular bonus.
Correct.
Yeah. I think it would be good when you bring this forward again, because this is just for information, that we maybe put a few examples in so people could see.
Correct.
All right. Mr. Bessie had his hand up.
Yeah. Two questions. Is residence within the neighborhood revitalization strategy area a requirement, or is that simply a marker for the low to moderate income status?
It's the marker for that status. I guess you could probably have a low or moderate income person outside that area. But that area is actually pretty large, but you could have a person outside of the area that you could also serve.
Yeah, it's a large area, but it's certainly not anything close to complementary with the city. I'd be interested in alternative ways to do that. Second, how do you distinguish our ability to offer additional bonus assistance based on those criteria from our inability, as we are told, to condition the financial assistance on those criteria in the first place?
I think what we're doing is trying to provide the incentive, and the general incentive is based upon jobs and capital investment. And I think divide that overall category, we've just chosen to come up with this formula. But legally, you can't force a company to say, I'm going to provide X number of jobs, and those jobs have to be provided to local residents. We're providing jobs. If you provide jobs, regardless of where they come from, you get this incentive. It's not tied to there being the overall job category. It's not tied to there being a local resident.
Yes, I understand. That's the result. What I'm asking is, where is the legal justification for saying that we can provide the bonus, but we can't condition the basic grant on in the first place?
That's the Privileges and Immunities Clause of the Constitution. That's the
which doesn't apply to the bonus.
Well, in talking with the School of Government, you've got the Privileges and Immunities Clause that applies generally, but because you have this statutory concept that allows municipalities to address the targeted population of low and moderate income, there is this theory that you can craft the language based upon that statutory authority. Can I assure you 100% that the Privileges and Immunities Clause does not trump the statutory authority? No, I cannot assure you of that. But given council's desire to try to help this targeted population, I've come up with the best argument for trying to do that.
Thank you. And basically, I'm not familiar of any specific legal basis for the distinction.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, because of that, I come back to the basic question. If we can do it this way, why can't we simply say you can't get the assistance unless the jobs that you provide go to city residents, for example, or for low and moderate income city residents?
Well, city residents, you don't have a statutory authority, you don't. It says city residents. But you do have statutory authority that says low and moderate income persons.
Mm-hmm.
So we've defined low and moderate income, and because we attached with that designation the neighborhood revitalization stabilization area, since we've attached that to low and moderate income, I've used that statute to say, well, as long as you provide jobs to the low and moderate income in this area, we can provide this bonus above the baseline that we provide. So you have a specific statute that addresses community development and employment to low and moderate income. It does not say residents. It says local. It says low and moderate income. I know that's probably complicated, but that's what I'm using, that statutory authority.
That's pretty straightforward, and it seems that if we could devise another marker,
but it doesn't say local residents.
No,
I haven't gone that far.
Low and moderate income. At any rate, it sounds as though there are other options within the theory that we could pursue, including possibly the idea of shifting more of the incentive from the basic any job you provide to saying, well, you only get X minus Y for every job, but you get a higher increment bonus for providing for low and moderate income.
Yes, I think you can do that. Again, under that community development statute, you not only have to be a local resident, but you have to be low and moderate income in a neighborhood.
The last five minutes confirms my decision. I made the right decision in not going to law school.
Not going to law school pays better.
To interpret it so that the rest of us understand what you're talking about.
In English,
is you have to be careful of what kind of restrictions you put. And what we're basically saying is if you hire anyone, as long as you pay them $10.48 an hour and you create at least 15 jobs with X amount of investment, whatever, you get certain incentives. But we can carve out specific incentives for folks living in the neighborhoods and ex-offenders. And Mr. Bessie is questioned whether or not we can do that, and if we can, why we can't carve out other exceptions.
I think he wants a title restriction so we can say local resident, perhaps. But what I'm saying is that the statute allows low or moderate income, and if we tie it to low and moderate income, since we have a neighborhood revitalization area that clearly is a market for low and moderate income, we can use that statute. And I think Councilmember Bessie wants to maybe do low and moderate income anywhere in the city, even outside that area.
Yeah.
Yes, but I'm also thinking to Councilmember Montgomery's point, which I think is well taken, $250
right.
A job is not much. But if we could do it at $250 a job, I don't see why we couldn't take more of that, you know, maximum of $1,500 a job and shift it.
Right.
Okay, Mr. Mayor, would you like to add to this conversation?
I'm going to do an amicus brief on this one.
Okay. I'm going to get my gavel. You get carried away here.
I really like the idea of creating this incentive for local hires. The thing with my opinion, you've got to keep in mind, you've got to get here first.
That's right, yeah.
Before you can have this. So we've got $250 may not be enough. But if you carve out too much of the base piece of it, you might not get the company and have an opportunity to do this. So I think we can come up with a way to make it work.
Yeah.
But you've got to get the company here first.
Because yeah. I had the same concern that you may have a company come in here that requires some unusual skills, and there may not be many folks in the area that have those skills, so they would be bringing folks in, which is
good as well. They moved the area by a house and all that type of stuff. So we need to be sure that we're not too restrictive. Yes, ma'am.
It's not local hire. It's low as moderate income.
Right. Well, Mr. Bessie wants it to be local. But
well,
anyway.
Mr. Bessie can't quite get that.
All right.
I know I can't get there.
He's not actually a member of this committee. I'm going to call him out of order. Ms. Light?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me get her name. Ms. Carman, it says someone who lives in the neighborhood revitalization strategy area. Mm-hmm. There may be some quite wealthy people who live in that area.
But you still have to be low or moderate income, right?
Correct.
In that area, basically.
Does it say that?
No, it doesn't.
That would be the parameter.
I'm not sure that's clear. It's not to me, anyway.
Ms. Burke, you had your hand up.
I want to say, Mr. Chairman and members of this committee, we're moving forward. Because if we were listening to some folks in this city, they would never want us to test or try anything. Now, if we're not strong enough and we put out some concerns that we're concerned about and how we want to spend these dollars and what we want to do as incentives, I think it's a plus. And I agree with what I've heard, and I don't want to take you back. But if with the jobs and the opportunities that we have used tax dollars for, and we are not moving, I think, like we ought to, I want to commend the attorney and Mr. Page, city manager, for bringing it. Let's test them. Mm-hmm. Let's
okay.
test them. That's what we're going to do.
All right. Ms. Adams?
Really?
Yeah, you're up, finally.
Yeah. I just want to add to it, Mr. Page, again, just like you said earlier, are there any other possible types of initiatives like this anywhere? If so, bring us back, just like we see in another couple of things on the general agenda, where you went and you found other cities who are basically doing something similar. If you can add that to it, and also the examples of other job incentive programs that we have, please do a matrix that shows side to side maybe what it is that we do and why we do it and how is this going to be somewhat different, if any, so everybody can get a snapshot. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Montgomery,
I'll get back to you. Last comment in reference to it, but when we're looking at these type of things, and I know sometimes we get uneasy at times when folks put more restrictions on certain things, but I do believe, you know, as a council member, we all represent different populations across the city. I represent individuals who live in NRSA, individuals who don't live in NRSA, individuals who are low to moderate income, the individuals that are not, and I think we all probably have a demographic of individuals across section of our community. And one thing that I hear consistently when we bring in companies and jobs, regardless of how big or small, that when they get dollars from our community, if they're not really given opportunities to get the jobs, the company might as well still be in Timbuktu to them because they don't have access to the jobs. And so we can find anything that can help make sure that people from a cross section of our community truly have access to the jobs that are being created. I think we have a responsibility to the people we serve to do so.
Okay. Ms. Carmen?
I just want to go back to Councilmember Light's question. GS 168-456 is a substance lower moderate. So that is the target population.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's enough. This is just for information only. Mr. Garrity, you heard, not Mr. Garrity, Mr. Page, excuse me. Y'all heard various comments. Let's see what we can do. I like Ms. Adams' comment particularly. Maybe we look at what some other folks have done to see how they tweaked it. It is a very delicate balancing act there. Last one we have is C-11.
Resolution to renew an agreement with Arista Information Systems Incorporated for outsourcing utility bill printing and mailing, amount not to exceed $217,200.
Ms. Saunders, would you give us an introduction to this, please?
Sure. Good afternoon, Chairman Clark, Mayor, and members of the council. The item before you today is consideration of a resolution to renew an agreement with Arista Information Systems for outsourcing our utility bill printing and mailing. The city began using Arista Information Systems in October of 2014, and they actually print and mail for us approximately 795,000 bills and notices on an annual basis. Arista uses a modern technology that actually takes advantage of the lowest postage rates and reduces waste through this process. Arista's been in business for 31 years. They're on Fairchild Drive in Winston-Salem. We actually are using the sole source provision to negotiate with Arista. It's a standardized file that works it's very integrated into our utility billing system, so to change vendors would be very costly to do that. So we have renegotiated the terms and the fees, actually have a reduced contract amount based on the volume that we do today. We estimate it to be $72,400 on an annual basis, or a savings of about $8,400 a year.
Okay, so about 10% reduction.
Right.
Questions or comments, Ms. Burke, did you
have? Yes, I believe this is in the Northeast Ward. Yeah. Ms. Saunders, I would just like to know the makeup of their employees.
Okay.
Always ask that question.
Okay.
Okay, any other, Mr. Montgomery?
Yes, I'd ask this to be pulled for a couple reasons. One, in looking at the time that we've done business with them, and I hear the statement in reference to costliness of changing vendors, but have we actually had any conversation with anyone else in reference to that, just in the sense to make sure, I know we've negotiated here, but do we have any other numbers to compare to see whether or not we are getting the best price? It may be, but it's always good and helpful to see it in comparative terms of what would that cost be to change vendors compared to what we were looking at, and what's the difference in what we're dealing with.
I'm going to look to our revenue collector, but I don't think we actually have. We have not.
Okay. I just think that in terms of consistently moving forward, I think it'd be well to look at those numbers, because maybe we are, maybe we're not. But for me, not being able to see it is just the standard of this is what we're being told, but not necessarily being able to have anything to compare it to. Second question on that is in reference to the actual mailing pieces, and may not be able to answer it, but we get a lot of emails, and there was actually one out of all of some of the crazy emails we get, there was actually one sentiment in one of the emails that I saw that actually made sense, and that was in reference to when we do our mailing and water bill mailings, in terms of when we do other pieces of mail that need to be sent out from other departments that is targeted to communities, how well can we utilize that service to actually do that to help reduce costs in other portions of and other areas of city government.
Okay, I'll get you the answer. I know we do stuffers into the water bill and send those out. But I'll
I'm asking in terms of if with other departments that do mailings, how can they utilize that to help reduce costs that in terms of...
Councilmember Montgomery, we try on a regular basis to use the utility billing system. We can get you more information. One of the challenges we have occasionally is the timing. You can't mail out... customers are on different cycles, billing cycles for the two-month period, so it takes to try to get a mailing to all citizens. There's a long period of to get it done, but we try for anything that's going out that doesn't have a short timeliness to it, like city scene or city whatever it's called, city scene that goes in there, city line, that's it. So it depends on whether it's got enough residents to stay good information for 2 months. If it's less than 2 months, it's difficult to do it in the utility bills.
But I'm even thinking about when we know we're having certain meetings and gatherings, if they're planned out in advance enough to be able to utilize that, and just from a cost standpoint, I'm not sure how much we really save, but utilizing that method as a way of getting the message out.
Okay.
But I'm abstaining tonight because I would like to have some more information on the comparison, even though I'm not sure that we'll have that, and I may be the only one, but that's some information I'd like.
Ms. Saunders, how time sensitive is this? Because this is a contract.
Yeah.
It expires when?
Expires this month.
Okay. You think you can have us some information by in a week?
We probably could do month to month.
We can probably go month to month and hold it if you want until we can bring it back.
Okay, why don't we do that? Why don't we bring it back next month and we'll see if we can do a one-month extension.
Yeah.
Okay.
And what I'm hearing, and well, let me, Ms. Adams, you go
ahead.
Yes,
thank you. I agree again. This is one of those bridges that we somehow continue to cross over when it comes to contracts and negotiations and decisions that are made by staff. We're not going to micromanage what you do, but when we see that when we come to us with things like this, and we've had the same business, not saying anything is wrong with the business that they've been providing us, But we've got to make sure that everybody has an opportunity when a contract comes up, unless, city attorney, there is something written that we don't have to let other businesses and vendors know about a contract when it's expiring, that anybody interested, put your bid in. Might be a new, young technology group, or maybe two or three printers get together and they share the cost and are able to hire a couple of more people or something. But, you know, again, I'm not against the people that have been doing it, but it just kind of reminds me of the person that's been the treasurer or an accountant for years of an organization and nobody's checking the books because they've been there for 20 or 30 years. I just think we need to be able to open it up to all of the citizens in the city. I just believe that. And I don't like it, Mr. Chair, again, when we get things that's like 2-3 weeks, we got to have an answer to it. I just wish we could get things more timely when we are making decisions about the money of the people.
Okay. Well, I hear a couple questions, and we'll see if you can get an extension so we can do this. One is, I think it would be helpful, since this contract's only a year old, to go back when we actually signed it and see how many bids we got then.
Okay.
An analysis there.
Okay.
I'm hearing some questions of, can you test the market to see if we're getting good value now? And a third kind of a related question was, do we coordinate this with other mailings to the extent we can? Maybe some examples of what we've been able to do.
Okay.
And I understand on the time, if it takes us 2 months, because we're on a 2-month billing cycle, it's got to be an unusual document to put in there that is still valid 2 months after the first one was mailed. Mm-hmm. I understand that. Okay.
And one last bit of question I forgot in terms of who, and I know this question about makeup, but I'd like to know who owns this company.
Okay.
And Mr. Chairman,
yes,
just indirectly, I would like someone to tell me you said it once before, we send our pay our utility bills out of Shaw. If there are companies that could do that here. Please.
All right.
Okay. So we've got a number of questions there.
Okay.
All right. That finishes the consent agenda. We will now go to the general agenda, which is composed of, I think I'm seeing seven items. And let me say before we start, I know last month we had a very, very busy month, and so folks that were on here last month got put off to this month. I thank you for your patience, particularly Mr. Leek. I see you sitting back there. Hopefully we will get to you today. With that in mind, we will do G1.
Resolution authorizing the city manager and his staff to request proposals for the sale of the Center City Parking Deck and Holly Avenue Surface Parking Lot. This item was continued from the February, March, and May meetings of the Finance Committee.
Mr. Turner, will you give us a rehash of the history of this, and then we'll see what we're going to go forward.
Certainly, Mr. Chairman, in light of your extensive general agenda, I'll try to be as brief as I can. Committee started reviewing this back in February. At that time, you had one offer to purchase the Center City West parking deck on 4th Street. Since then, that offer has increased in its commitment to economic development, which is tied to its purchase. And we have also since then received an additional offer for the possible purchase of the deck. The two offers are summarized on page 2 of your package. The only differentials between the two are in terms of the taxable new development, where one property would be providing $21 million, the other one would be providing $30 million in new development. The other differential, a second differential, is the maximum distance to the new development, not a substantial issue, but one is 1,500 feet away and the other is 1,000 feet away. And the final differential is one has committed to provide workforce housing as indicated in the table. There was also a question about whether the city could approach Wells Fargo, formerly Wachovia, about buying out their remaining financial commitment to the city for the spaces they're leasing in the deck. We have asked them. They've indicated they would be interested in it verbally, and that rate would be at a 70% discount. However, both of the, yes, discount.
That's a huge discount, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It is. 30%. However, both of the potential purchasers have indicated to us that they were anticipating the monthly revenue from Wells Fargo as part of their offer in order to give them revenue until such time as their development is complete. I'll be happy to answer any questions the committee has. This item is for your consideration. There's one other thing I suppose I should point out, and that is that there is a Exhibit A which would list, on page 9, which would list the minimum requirements in an RFP that might go on the street if the city council decided they wanted to sell the stack. This RFP obviously does capture the minimum requirements of both potential property or purchasers and does not add anything that's unique to each one.
Okay. Mr. Turner, let me try to summarize so everyone up here understand what we're doing and not doing. What we're looking for is to send this forward to the full council to vote, in which case we would go out and ask people for RFPs, which is a request for proposals. They would give us back whatever they want to, and I would envision that they would look different. We are putting it here under Exhibit A, kind of the minimum items we would want them to address, but they can be creative or whatever they may wish on their proposals. We would then review the proposals and decide which one we liked, and then that proposal we would go back out and take upset bids purely on the price differential. The other correct terms would stay the same.
Correct. That is correct.
And we could, if after receiving, and there may be other proposals we get, we don't know, we could reject them all if we wanted to.
That is also correct.
But what we're basically doing is if we pass this tonight, we're saying, okay, community, come back to us with some proposals that we can evaluate.
Yes.
Okay. Ms. Light, start with you.
So, in effect, we are not making a decision between the two
no
proposals mm-hmm in front of us. Mm-hmm.
We really don't have proposals. What we have are some information we got from some folks, but nothing legally. And by the way, I believe one of the parties is here today. Is that correct?
I'm not sure that they are. I didn't see them in the audience.
Okay, I'm sorry. Sorry. Yes, you're correct. We're simply saying, folks, we have an idea. Please send us in writing what you're really willing to do. Any other questions, comments? Okay.
I move approval of the resolution.
We have a proposal to send this forward for RFPs, Mr. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Montgomery, do you have a question? Comment?
Yeah, quick question. On the spacing, on the parking space portion, on the Holly Avenue lot restriction, can someone explain that just a little bit more for me?
Holly Avenue would be reserved for use of the public until such time as it's developed, and if it is developed, it would be restricted for development as residential. And the public would include the baseball stadium.
Right. So it currently is a surface lot with no meters on it, is that?
That is correct.
So anyone could park there, including baseball games, whatever?
Yes. Now, the restriction would not prevent them from putting meters in. It would only require that it be available for the public. They could make revenue off of it.
Okay. All right. Any other, Ms. Gorman?
Just for clarification, this is going to full council because it's setting the minimum kind of requirements.
Yes.
That anyone would have to place a bid based on.
That's right. It is going to council. Mr. McIntosh.
Just a comment. My only heartburn about this is that we don't have two decks to sell, because it would be really nice to have both of these developments done, and I'm hoping that whoever doesn't get the deck finds a way to build their project out, because these are two really amazing developments that will benefit our downtown,
okay,
whole city.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise? Abstain. And one abstention. So we have three in favor, none opposed, one abstention. So council, if they so approve, we will then get proposals and then see where we want to go with from there forward. G2.
Resolution adopting guidelines for affordable workplace housing assisted with city funds. This item was continued from the May meetings of the Finance and Community Development, Housing, and General Government Committees.
Mr. Norby's not here. Mr. Brooks, are you going to talk to us?
I'm going to talk to you about the part that pertains to the policy itself, and I noticed Mr. Norby had provided some information that I was not aware would be a part of the package.
Okay. Well, you tell us whatever you want to tell us.
Page 37.
Oh, excuse me.
37.
Yeah, page 37 is where Mr. Brooks' item, the memo from Mr.
Very
Norby.
Brief.
Okay, if we'll turn
because
to
you
page
guys
37,
have,
you keep going.
You guys have seen this item before. It's the workforce housing policy. And as we had mentioned previously, when we're using federal funds, there oftentimes are restrictions for those funds in with regards to income or rents that can be charged, and we have to comply with those regulations. when we're using federal funds, and it may be mixed with other sources of funds, state funds, of course you cannot dismiss using those requirements also. What we were asked to do was to look at projects that were funded strictly with city, locally funded money, and to recommend a workforce housing policy that would address that, and we've attempted to do that. And the policy is simply that when you have a project that 5% of the total units must be leased to households whose income are between 50 and 80% of the area median income, and for a one-person household, that would be $19,650 to $31,450. For a household of four, that would be $28,050 and $44,900. So you would have 5% that would be in that category, and then the other 5% would be between 80 and 120%. And the 80 and 100% category for a one person would be $31,450, and 120 would be $47,100. For a family of four, 80% would be $44,900, and 120 would be $67,300. So those would be the income ranges that we would expect to see when projects are funded from locally derived funding, and it would be, we would recommend at least 10% of the total units fall within that category, or based on the performer, there could be some variation of those numbers, but we would look for at least 10% to fall within one of those two categories. And the term of that would be for 15 years, as is what we normally look at those projects for. And of course, our funds are provided on gap financing basis, which is generally no more than 20% of city investment in the project.
Could I suggest, if this goes to the full board, that you put those numbers in that you just listed? We don't have them in here, I don't see.
They were provided to you in a memo.
Well, just be sure they're in the booklet for the full meeting.
Okay.
Okay. So what you're saying, if it's federal or state monies, they have their own guidelines that we adhere to, but if it's just city money, these would be the guidelines.
That's correct.
All right. And what you've given us, the specific numbers you've just given us, were ranges of what the percentages would be.
That's correct. And that's as of March of this year.
Okay. One question I have, if you have a project and it's supposed to be 5% of whatever one of these ranges, and no one applies, what does the developer do?
No one applies.
Or not enough apply. I got 100 units.
I would think in the real world, if no one applies, the developer could not be responsible for that. But if the developer is marketing the units, mm-hmm, and it's marketed as an affordable housing project, then I would think that there should not be a problem in being able to get those categories of individuals that... I just don't.
You don't think that would be a problem?
No, no.
Okay.
That's a long stretch.
Okay. All right. Thank you. We have other questions, comments, Ms. Montgomery. You had your hand up.
I did. One, this has been an item that I have very much championed and really pushed us to consider, in the fact that when we look at housing in our community and how we assure that we have a diversity of housing options financially for individuals. And I bring up the fact that I believe that this item is tied to one item we talked about in economic development in terms of incentive pieces of what we do. Because if we could pay, everyone could get a job that paid well, we wouldn't even have to worry about in terms of affordable housing. But we know that everybody has different incomes based upon the level and job in which they're in. So therefore, in our community, we have to find ways to create spaces that provide opportunities for housing for people at every level of income, and that housing should be quality housing in the sense of they should be able to live in something that most people would be okay living in and doesn't have to have all of the luxuries, but at least something that people are happy to be in. And so that's the comment. The question is two-part with the time frame on these units being online. What is that time frame in terms of if they provide these, how long does that developer have to provide the units at that time?
What we have recommended in the policy would be for a 15-year period. Of course, if council chose to change that period, you may do so.
And the reason I pulled that out is because as we continue to grow as a community and based upon the stats and how individuals are spending their money and particularly the inequity and amount of money that is spent on individuals who are low and moderate income in terms of how much of their income they spend on housing, which is disproportionate, that 15 years only means that in 15 years after these units are offline, we have now subtracted that many more affordable and workforce housing units from out of the community. And so therefore it's a question of, at that time, there's going to be a need for more of those type of units. But now with this piece, they are subtracted out of the number that's considered. And so how do we maintain a sense of encouraging individuals to maintain those for a longer period of time than the 15 years? Because yes, we around this table may change in 15 years, but the fact of still needing workforce housing is not gonna go away. And so they get the money, it's good, and they're gonna make money for more than 15 years. So we wanna do this trade-off and encourage development and encourage them to invest, but also where's that balance? And to me, I'm still challenged on the 15 years because I'm looking at long-term impact for us as a community. And when those go away, we're back in the same situation as a community with having less workforce housing units than we did after that 15-year period. I don't know what the answer is per se in terms of how far out we go. I know there's a challenge in terms of development community on their income in terms of what they want to net out of the development pieces of it. But I don't know if there's a way for it that this is something that's indefinite as a part of the project. And that would be something I would love for us to consider, but I'm not sure if we've heard any response from the development community in reference to that.
No, we haven't. We have not heard. Generally, when you're dealing with federal money, it's tied to the term of the loan. So if your loan term would be 15 or 20 or 25 years, that would generally be the period of affordability.
So we could do that here, maybe tie it to the term of the
loan. You could tie it to the term of the loan.
That correct. Probably makes sense. Ms. Burke?
I was going to ask for something to come to me after you finish with this concerning housing.
Okay, all right. Ms. Adams, you have anything?
Yes. One of the things I think I mentioned a few years ago when the recession hit, that one of the things of the future, I know some of the realtor people are doing real well in the real estate market, residential, but those are the people that can afford it. The people that can't afford it and hurt the most during the recession, even before it happened, they lost their homes, but all they'll be able to do, as I said before, is rent. And what people are finding out is most people that lost their homes and are renting, they will choose to continue to rent because of all of the financial responsibilities that go with home ownership. The thing that I think that, again, we always need to keep in mind with these rates of trying to provide affordable housing is that keeping the ability to live in a quality dwelling at a level or rate that you and your family can afford. And even some of the data that they gave to us, that Paul gave to us, says that the trend is people are going to be renting more spaces. And if you look at the matrix that he provided on page 32, in some of the places in Winston, that these rents, you know, up was almost $2,000 to rent a two-bedroom unit. I mean, I don't know anybody. I couldn't even afford that, unless you guys are going to pay me more, Chair. But I would be interested to see.
I think we get money. We don't.
They don't pay us. But I would be interested to see, just like what you have here, Mr. Brooks, some of the affordable housing communities or apartments that are here in the city, just to see what they look like side by side. Like, this is middle upward, am I right? These units, I'd like to see the same number, amount, of some of the areas in our city and units where they are affordable housing and what their rent rates are compared to the, on a two-bedroom versus these. Thanks.
Yeah, maybe some examples in other apartment complexes.
We can do that.
Ms. Burke?
I was going to ask if Mr. Brooks would bring to us so we can see. We have quite a few Habitat houses that the city has worked with. Mm-hmm. And also we have houses when they had those dollar lots that we have throughout this city. And most of these people have stayed. We have only a few went into foreclosure. Mm-hmm. What I would like to see, let's say if we were talking about the Pittsburgh area over there in the North Ward, how many of those houses are still ownership? If we look at Habitat near the Bethlehem Baptist Church, how many of those people are still in those houses? We and the number of housing that we have assisted with developers and with Habitat, we've been rather successful. I don't think we've had too many of them in the foreclosures, but you know my ward, the ward I represent and the ward Mr. Taylor represent, we have been hit hard with foreclosures. Mm-hmm. And the people have lost their houses, and they're going to be the ones that are mm-hmm. going to be renting.
Absolutely.
Thank okay. you. Go around the table. Ms. Light, you hit your hand up.
Thank you. I think one of the most important pieces of data in Mr. Norby's report is that poverty levels are going to perpetuate themselves if children stay in a low, in a high poverty area, and that this sort of incentive should, in fact, be used in low poverty areas, like some of these on page 32. If you provide this same sort of incentive to an area that has high poverty anyway, you're not helping people. I think that the major emphasis ought to be on making these guidelines apply to the more you know, the areas that are near grocery stores, near good schools, and you know, try to bring that influence to you know, low and moderate income people.
Okay, Mr. McIntosh, you have your hand up.
This is a policy that would apply citywide, correct?
Correct.
We're not just talking about Central Business District, although
correct.
I think the focus that we're on right now is Central Business District because that's where everything's being built. I think we have this data, and I think it was presented in a different form, but I'd like to see how many units of affordable housing we do have downtown. And I know that we had a chart before that showed that, but not in a format that really I'm looking for. But can we take an inventory? I think we probably have a fair number of units, but I agree. I think we're still listening to experts like the Urban Land Institute. We're facing a shortage of apartments that's going to, I think, shock people over the next 5 years. So I think that applies across the board in all price categories. And I think that we do need to be very conscious about workforce housing. In terms of holding a developer to longer than 15 years, or I think the term of the mortgage makes more sense, because I think by the time that mortgage is paid off, if it's a 20-year note, housing market will have changed a fair degree. And I think we could end up with unintended consequences by holding somebody to something that makes sense in 2015, but 20 years down the road has no relevance in the market. So I think we should not tie them down too long. Section 8 housing loans sometimes, and they were 30-year loans, and some of them, and it took a long time for some of them to go away, and we dealt with their negative outcomes. Lastly, I think this is one part of a housing policy that I think needs to be more well integrated. We seem to be attacking this kind of like we do the bus system. We keep adding routes. I think that at some point we really need to see how all this fits together. We spend a lot of money. I think we're overall fairly proud of what we do in the housing business, but I think we do spend money here and there kind of at cross purposes. I think at some point we really do need to all sit around a table and talk about what's the big policy and how do we make it, how is it most effective, how do we spend our money the best.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Bessie?
Yeah. Some questions about the specifics on the guideline proposals. The 3D, the city financial assistance, generally will be in the form of a loan. Typically, what are the terms of a loan that we'd be talking about in this context?
Usually those are amortizing loans. There could be some with a portion that may be deferred. For the most part, they are amortizing loans.
And explain for the general public what an amortizing
loan is. They're loans that require the funds to be paid back at some interest rate. Generally, it's 0 to 5, 6 at a max. Probably, I would say the average would probably be about 4%.
All right, so below market?
Yes, below market.
All right, and the wording of these guidelines is generally pretty flexible. And you're saying, generally, the city will do this. We'll determine a percentage in that range. Given appropriate circumstances, we can shift that. Am I reading that?
That's correct. What we wanted to do is be able to allow there to be some flexibility. Here we've listed 5% in certain ranges, but the developer could present 10% all at the 80 to 120, or it could be a combination of some in the lower and some in the higher.
And they could go over 10% for, you know, appropriate.
We would certainly love to see it over 10%. That's correct.
All right, thank you. Just a comment. Our colleagues are correct. This is an increasing need in the city. You may have heard I'm dealing now with a project proposal in my district inside of Baptist Hospital that would, in its initial proposed form, completely eliminate 350-plus units of affordable housing.
Including yours.
Now, a caveat, mine there is going to be gone at the end of September. I'm moving at the end of my current lease in order to avoid any questions of conflict.
Well, we appreciate that.
Deal with that. But you know, that's a project proposal which is quite reasonable from the standpoint of the ownership group, which has analyzed that they can make a lot more money off that site if they raise the current structures and rebuild from scratch. But if that happens, that's going to be blow a big hole in the stock of affordable housing in a substantial part of the city. So looking at how to deal with that.
Thank you, Mr. Bessie. Mr. Montgomery.
Yes, two pieces. One, in reference to the beyond the 15-year piece of that, I'm willing for us to move something forward that has the 15 years, and that's part of that, with an understanding that we come back and we do what I believe Councilmember McIntosh stated, and which I think I've talked about and I think others have, in terms of really looking at really comprehensive housing-wise, what and how are we working as a community to really work with these pieces of housing and impacting housing. And one note there is the fact that, you know, I don't want folk to get mixed up what we're attempting to do here. We're not attempting to recreate housing authority and create Section 8 housing. Mm-hmm. It's in the sense of what we do for workforce housing, and really in an attempt to be able to fill a void that exists in our community where individuals who could not receive housing and support under guidelines that are in place with our housing authority because they wouldn't qualify, but they're still in a place of their income level not being able to access that affordable housing piece that's there. And I sent out a email several months ago to an article that speaks of what we're dealing with and what other cities are dealing with our reinvestment in center cities, which is a great reinvestment, but there's also the byproducts of what we're seeing, just of what Councilmember Bessie has stated and others, that those who have been impoverished or those who have low and moderate income who were left in center cities and urban cores are now being shifted outward to the suburbs as individuals are moving back in. And so we have that responsibility in some way just to look out for that total pie. But I would remove my objection in sense of that 15-year piece if we're able to really commit ourselves to a comprehensive look to what we're doing and how we're working.
Okay, so motion move G2 forward.
I move that we move the resolution forward with the added proposal of Councilmember Montgomery to come back and revisit once we do a comprehensive housing review.
All right, is there a second?
Second. With that understanding and other things.
All right. Okay, we have a motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Folks, we're going to go, do we go to 6:30, Mr. or 6?
We've got 15 minutes, and we'll talk about it a little bit.
May I suggest we have some visitors here, and I see Mr. Leek, and is the fairground folks here as well?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why don't we do those two? Because that so that would be G3 and
3 and 4.
Yeah. G what?
3 and 4.
3 and 4. So let's go to G3. Ben.
Final report on the Winston-Salem Fairgrounds operational review and master plan study. This item was continued from the July meeting of the Finance Committee.
First off, thank y'all for being patient with us. We seem to have had some very full agendas the last few months. Please introduce yourselves, give us your name and address for the record, and you have the floor. Ben, you want to introduce them?
Sure. Good afternoon, Chairman Clark, Mayor Joins, and members of the City Council. Last September, the City engaged Crossroads Consulting Services and Kefir Overton Fairground Planners to conduct an operational review and a master plan study of the Winston-Salem Fairgrounds. Today, Susan Seeger with Crossroads Consulting and Chip Overton Kefir Overton Fairgrounds Planners are going to present the final report from their study.
And really quickly, just as a reminder,
please give your name and address for the record, please.
Susan Seeger, 3944 Shorekers Boulevard, St. Petersburg, Florida.
Thank you. Please continue.
Chip Overton, KO Fairground Planners, West Des Moines, Iowa.
Okay, thank you.
Really quickly, this was a complex study in that we did an operational review and also a master plan, so we're going to hit on the highlights of both of those components. And our scope was really looking at your existing facilities at the fairgrounds, both from a market perspective as well as a physical perspective, understanding a management, how well the management team is doing, and that was really done through a competitive assessment. So looking at facilities that are A, competitive, but B, comparable to understand best industry practices. And then that's going to culminate into a master plan and also a cost-benefit analysis.
So really after looking at the market, we are, in order to get a good grasp of how that market study applies to the existing fairgrounds, we needed to look at the facilities themselves. So as we looked at the facilities, there were 30 different buildings as well as the site we evaluated. As we looked that over, we looked at several criteria. We looked at the exterior of buildings. We looked at the conditions of concrete. We looked at the conditions of windows, et cetera. I guess the good news is you have good stock. About 70% of everything that the fairgrounds has, we categorized as good, fair, or excellent condition. And you can see by these heat maps, bright red being the worst condition, and then the orange, which is very close to the red color, by the way, the secondary condition, then yellow, then green, as the conditions get in better shape. And then as you move to the site, you can see that the conditions of the midway are probably in worse condition, as well as the paving areas in and around the RV sites, clear on the upper right-hand corner there of the diagram itself. The fairgrounds itself, the body of the fairgrounds, which is yellow, there's several cracked concrete areas and several areas that need repair as well.
And as I mentioned, one of our tasks was to look at how well the management team is doing. So we looked at, this is a snapshot of the facilities and the areas of operations that we looked at in terms of mission statement, organizational structure, marketing, financial performance. And just to hit on a couple of the highlights, we grouped them by major function. And really, your fairground staff is lean would be an understatement. So one of our first recommendations is to hire a business manager to help with both fair and non-fair activities. And the other benefit you have is the ability to have a lot of your administrative functions at the city level. That should absolutely continue because it does allow for efficiencies, but we still think you need a couple full-time staff, including that business manager. The other is moving forward, one of the recommendations is as you move forward with these recommendations and the operating income increases, that you put that money back into the fairgrounds. Chip's going to go over it in a little bit about how some of the master plan recommendations are deferred maintenance. So if you're able to move forward and address those, the recommendation would be to continue to try and put operating income back into it. On the sales and marketing side, this is another area we think you need a full-time staff that would really target non-fair niches. And we really see that as a lot of ICE events, competitive sport competitions, agricultural events, meeting banquets, RV rallies is a huge one. So there's some areas that we think you're not maximizing right now, particularly as we continue to improve the asset. That's really the major one, but one of the areas we see moving forward is to try and drive towards multi-day events. RV rallies can be 3, 4, 5 days, where we're trying to maximize that non-fair time. The other area we think maybe you're not taking as full advantage of is on the advertising sponsorship area. You know, just with the fair alone, you have 350,000 people for just that 10-day period. So we think you should either look at doing a full-time person or perhaps just doing a contract and try and maximize that, because both the marketing sales and the sponsorship advertising piece will pay for themselves, you know, through that investment. The third area that was key was the farmers market. And there are a lot of farmers markets in this area, in this state. And one of the things is we want to define expectations moving forward, that's still what we want it to be. We think that you need to consider maybe scheduling it less frequently and also implementing some policies to make sure that there's greater consistency and participation. You just can't pay a fee for the year and not show up, so that irrespective of the week you come in, you have the same vendors.
So as we look big picture at the fairgrounds itself, we have several recommendations in order to generate more revenue for the fairgrounds. And as we look at those revenue generators, they actually start to translate into actual facility improvements. The facility improvements that you see on this particular diagram start to light up in the turquoise or the blue color on the plan itself, and they categorize into 7 different areas: exhibition, food court, livestock, camping, the carnival, recreation and performance areas, and then just the grounds in general. So as we start to look at the grounds, aesthetics become very important, wayfinding becomes very important, really understanding and a way to get people to move around the fair that makes sense, as well as just general updates in the visual appearance of things and a way to get people pushed through the site. So in this particular diagram, we're looking at the food court. As you move into the food court area, there is actually a food court building we're looking at taking out, and then we're looking at beautifying it with either a landscape garden or with in this particular instance, a water feature. That water feature then can be enhanced, and the food court experience can be greatly increased by creating shade structures and, you know, the ability for people to enjoy themselves instead of sitting just on a hot asphalt eating area. And then taking a look across the fairgrounds to the south, looking on the left of this particular image is the new agricultural building, which is a freestanding column-free exhibition space, which will take the place of the existing agricultural building and the poultry building. And then on the right is the sheep swine barn, which is going to be enhanced in, as Susan had talked about previously, the farmer's market. This particular diagram looks at Gate 21, which is clear at the southeast corner of the fairgrounds. This is the home and garden building that you see in front of you. Actually, what we're focusing on here is trying to separate the traffic flow of animals and people and vehicles. If you've ever entered on that particular corner of the fairgrounds, you know how big of a mess that can become and how dangerous it can actually become at times. This is another example of looking at the ticket gate. Actually, in the background of this image is the annex building. To the right is the education building. We're proposing a link structure that connects these two buildings. That would allow for larger contiguous events to utilize the flat floor space, the exhibition space in both buildings in one connected event. This is the overall budget for the entire project. $28.7 million is the overall probable cost for all of the improvements. Of course, we're not proposing that you take on all those improvements at any one given time. It's important that you look at this as a phased project. The type of phasing we're looking at really starts to look at beautifications, aesthetic improvements, revenue generation improvements, safety improvements in all three phases, really focusing on safety and deferred maintenance in phase one. And then phase two starts to focus on more of the secondary revenue generators, as well as deferred maintenance that has to relate more to the exterior of the buildings and the concrete and the lighting and things like that. And then phase three is probably more of the less revenue generators, I would call them, although needed, but not as highly impactful. And then all the deferred maintenance items that are on the interior, I'd say the easy stuff, the carpet, the paint, things like that, restroom updates, kitchen updates. And this is how we've proposed those three phases break down. Roughly phase one, as it is proposed currently, is at 11 million. Phase two is about 10.5, and phase three is at right around $7 million total.
And I think, as Chip mentioned, we really see this as a guideline or a roadmap for the future. This is really a long-term strategy, and those items can move around as situations change and as there's much more involvement as it relates to budget. But we do know the remaining status quo will likely continue to result in a loss of event activity and thereby revenue. So, you know, right now you're one of the few fairgrounds and only one of three of the profiled ones that makes money, and some lose a lot of money, so you should be proud of that. But that's not going to continue forever if you don't change your asset, because your competitors are changing their asset and improving it. So we really think this will help with your marketability and competitive position. So with the master plan, we do think that you're going to continue to support your operations with operating revenues. And we want that to continue. That was one of the charges. That was one of our prioritization challenges. But this is really an opportunity for a financial investment to positively impact the broader economy. But it's also very unlike other governmental initiatives where you go through the process and you actually find the money to fund it, and then you have to fund the operations as well. So if you look at some of your parks and libraries, that type of thing, this will actually be self-sustaining from an ongoing perspective. And with that, we'll open it up to any questions.
Questions, comments? Ms. Adams.
Thank you again for the time that you put in to do this. We appreciate it. Again, it's just like you said, it's a master plan, it's a roadmap. But I found it very interesting that the farmer's market is in phase two versus phase one. As a matter of fact, I go to the farmer's market practically every Saturday. And just this Saturday, past Saturday, some of the comments from the vendors were, we're seeing a lot more traffic, Dee Dee. Sometimes we're wondering, worried about the space of how the vendors can utilize more build out, but then they're concerned because sometimes they're got all this foot traffic coming through. Again, I know the farmer's market, like we discussed, has been there forever, but this is the original farmer's market in Winston-Salem in this area. And if we did anything, Pierce, since you're all here, I would like to see that farmer's market move to the top of the list, because I believe, just like I've communicated, for 6 years, if we can put some money into that farmer's market, we've done the little improvements, we've made some little things happen, but there's still some things, low-hanging fruit, that we could do to make that farmer's market a destination location more so on Saturdays than it is, Chair Clark. I really believe that.
Ms. Mike?
Just to add to that, I think one of the places where our city farmers market loses ground, loses customers, is that there's not any requirement for produce to be organic or, you know, that sort of thing. And people won't go if that's not the product that they want. So I think that should be a part of our upgrading.
Right.
Mr. Taylor.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you for the presentation. I think it was very informative. I debated members of the committee and members of the council whether I wanted to bring this up, and no way am I making any suggestions. But, you know, if we think about the larger complex of the Winston-Salem Fairgrounds, we have to talk about the Winston-Salem Fair. Here I see several recommendations for sales and marketing efforts, one of them being hire a sales and marketing manager to market to more multi-day events. I was wondering, had you considered, given the complexity of what's going on the national level with the naming of the fairgrounds, well, the naming of the actual fair, the Dixie Classic Fair, no matter what you say, there's going to be a lot of people who like the Dixie Classic Fair name. There's going to be a lot of people who don't like the Dixie Classic Fair name, and that could possibly hurt or help revenues depending on which side that you might be on. I see there are a number of suggestions here. Have there been any thoughts given to the actual name of the fair?
We weren't that specific as it relates to the name. Our first, kind of question was, how open was the city philosophically to selling naming rights in general? Some fairgrounds are very aggressive about it, and some are like, no, you know, this is what we want it to be. This is our image. So I think there are a lot of opportunities. Again, you have a critical mass of folks, and, you know, we were talking, there was a survey done maybe in 2007, but 45% originate from outside Forsyth County. So there's a lot of opportunity if you're a sponsor, and then increasing this non-fair. So we didn't look at the actual name of the fair, but I think there's a lot of opportunities. That is one if the city chooses to go that direction. But naming of different buildings and having some higher technology where you can have some changing, you know, advertising, it's a huge opportunity that you're not taking advantage of right now.
Members of the council, I would have to say, I don't, I'm not asking you to talk about it, but I don't particularly like the name of Dixie Classic Fair. That's neither here nor there, but we do have an opportunity in front of us to have a little bit more revenue come in for the fair and for the city in Winston-Salem here at this particular facility. I ask that we just consider it as we continue to move forward with these discussions.
Okay. Any other questions, Ms. Montgomery?
Yes. Two parts. One, just to point that Councilmember Taylor made, I'm just speaking to someone here recently. I think last time the city probably highly considered that. I think they said former council member, former state representative Larry Wamba was on council at that time, and it was a highly contested discussion, which I don't think if we take it up now, it would be much of the same. But if that's something we decide to do, I think it's a conversation worth having. But to the city manager, my question is to you on this, but more specifically in reference to the positions that are recommended to be hired here. Out of the business manager and the sales manager, how much of those positions were considered and what was proposed to us on cost savings as associated to the sale of Lawrence Joel? Because we had those type of roles that may have worked in tandem with the Coliseum and with the overall complex. So how much of were those positions a part of what we put in as cost savings because we eliminated those that facility?
Councilman Gomer, I'd have to go back and look at the details. As I recall, you know, most of those positions that we had previously were focused on the Coliseum. I don't think we ever really had a major focus on marketing the fairgrounds for other events, which is what this would be. But I need to go back and take a look at it. I can look at that and see exactly what we said at the time.
Yes, as we go back, the fair always appeared to be sort of one side. Even what they hired. And then I had encouraged that we would hire a diversity. And I think we put one, but you had quite a number of minorities in Winston-Salem attending the fair. And then the people that they brought here, it was sort of one side because it was for not, I didn't enjoy some of the people they brought here because I didn't like it. I felt there should have been more of attracting more diversity. Did you consider that in a way, some of the things that they have been doing through the years, the people that they have been having for the entertainers?
Not so much in terms of the diversity of the entertainers. We were more focused on, right now you're less than half in terms of staffing of you know, your average for your profile facilities. So we were really focusing on what positions can place us in a better position and maybe get more return on that investment. But in terms of specific event activity, no, not so much. Just how successful it's been at the fair and whether you should continue with that.
Just for my information, I'd like you to bring me something on the entertainers through the years mm-hmm. and also the makeup of the employees. And it went to deaf ears for some. Mr. Sparks is a nice man, but... And also, I want to know what is truly the responsibility of the people sitting on the Fairgrounds Commission, those individuals.
Okay. I think a lot of what your report addresses is outside the actual 10 days of the fair.
Correct.
Because
it's really meant to maximize the other 355 days.
That's kind of maximized now. You may want to tweak it a little bit. But the question is, do you want to go hire some other folks to try to bring in more RV right. events and right. this, that, and the other? We do have, I'm looking at city manager, we do have a public facilities commission. Do we also have a fairgrounds commission?
The fair planning commission, okay. which is a subsidiary of the public commission.
I would suggest we've got the report to let those two committees work through it and come back if there are any specific suggestions. I do think it's...
May I ask?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Did they present something to them today?
Today they, we presented
okay.
it to
them. Okay, yeah, I figured they would. Because I do think it is an interesting question. We have 10 days a year when the fairground is used quite extensively, and that's usually 1st of October when the fair is here. But the rest of the year, it's used a little bit, but obviously not as much. The question is, how much money do we want to put into it, and what are the potential returns from that? And we do have a commission that can examine that for us. Yes, sir.
Just quickly, who do we compete with in this space? I mean, there must be other people have discretionary dollars. Who else do they choose to go spend them with?
So it depends on, I mean, you're unique in the assets you have, right? So the fair, you got the fair. I mean, next to the state fair, you're the fair by a long shot. So when you look into more of the annex, for instance, that's sports and entertainment, that's an area we don't see a lot of potential in. You know, you got Greensboro, you got the building right across the parking lot you used to have, you got amphitheaters, you got it, you got it. So that's an area we don't see. So that's where, if you read through, we see more the ice events that you're already doing, continue to maximize that. Both through extending the season as well as some pricing increases as we improve the asset.
And those events really bring in people that stay, and heads and beds, that whole deal.
They bring in two things. Your users are bringing in your cash, but then those tournaments and the sports competitions, which you could absolutely work in tandem with your convention center and other assets you already have in the community, they definitely bring a lot of people that spend a lot of money in your community. And you really have a captive audience. So that's where we try and focus. And even the RV rallies, once you get on that circuit, you're on that circuit. And they stay 5-7 days. So, you know, they're not just having that. They're eating in your restaurants, too. They're renting your space out to have their banquet. So that's what we were trying to maximize. But the trick was, we were definitely given the charge to make sure there were still affordable activities and free activities. So you almost want some of those higher paying ones to offset that other activity, because it still has to be affordable to the majority of the population. That's really its mission statement.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all very much.
Good job.
Mr. Leak, you're up. Mr. Taylor, we're going to do at least one more here, if that's okay.
That's okay.
Mr. Lake, if you give your name and address for the record, we know who you are.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Get it on the.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mayor, Vice Mayor Burke, and members of the council. Thank you for having me. You'll see the date on this presentation is April 13th. I've been delayed a few times in being here, but I appreciate the opportunity to be with you today. I'm Bob Leak. My address is 1080 West 4th Street, Winston-Salem 27101. I was asked by Mr. Page to come to you and talk a little bit about Winston-Salem Business Inc. Talk a little bit about our marketing, which you all are major investors in, to talk about our targeting strategy, kind of companies and industry sectors that we're looking at trying to attract to Winston-Salem and Forsyth County, and to talk a little bit about some of the challenges and opportunities that we all deal with as we try to grow this community. I'll start by telling you and reminding you that Winston-Salem Business Inc. is a private nonprofit economic development corporation, 501c3. We have three people on staff, and our mission is to recruit new businesses to Winston-Salem and Forsyth County. We were founded in 1987, and since that time, we've assisted about 143 companies that have created over 16,000 jobs and expanded the tax base of Winston-Salem by over $1.7 billion. You can see from this chart, and I apologize, and don't try to read it, it's simply a bullet chart to show the years of job creation and investment by years since 1987. And you'll see, I mean, it's not a flat line what we do. Some years we have a lot of investment and fewer jobs. Some years companies create a lot of jobs where there's not as much investment. But over time it normalizes out, and you see that we have had some very good years in both investment and job creation. We partner with several other local organizations. We get asked all the time, there seems to be a lot of organizations that do, quote, economic development. And if you don't understand what's kind of behind the curtain, you might think that. But this chart simply shows that there are six primary organizations that have some form of economic development in their mission statement. Of course, Winston-Salem Business does business recruiting. You've got the Winston-Salem Chamber, the Winston-Salem Alliance, and the Downtown Partnership. And then we also have Visit Winston-Salem. It does more hospitality recruiting, and you've got the Innovation Quarter, which focuses entirely on the research park here in downtown Winston-Salem. But we all work very, very closely together. And about 2 years ago, we put together a strategic plan, and it's called the 2020 Plan. And I won't bore you by reading all of this. You can look at it at your leisure, and I can send larger copies if anyone needs to see it. But essentially what we did was we looked at key initiatives that we feel like need to happen in this community if we're going to be successful in creating jobs and expanding the tax base. And we wanted to know which agency was going to put their hand up and say, we'll be responsible for trying to lead that charge. And so the blue represents the lead agency. Green is a supplemental agency. So where you see certain initiatives, you go across and you see the blue agency would be, say, the Winston-Salem Chamber halfway down on that initiative, and they'd be supported by the Alliance and by Winston-Salem Business. So it gives us a measuring tool. Every year we report back on the results. There was a big community meeting this year that was held over at the convention center, and this was a key part of that presentation, is where are we on these metrics and how are we doing in trying to reach that target. Our program of work includes cluster business development, marketing, regional collaboration, and real estate assistance. I'm going to take just a minute to go through what those initiatives mean. Our cluster industry targets are really based on kind of long-term growth strategies in the community, and we look at things like advanced manufacturing, logistics and distribution because of the highway network and the access to five ports within about 4 hours, 5 hours of Winston-Salem, office and downtown development, life sciences, and green initiatives, which is a relatively new target for us. And I'll tell you a little bit about these. Advanced manufacturing, really what that is taking traditional industries and using automation, computerization, and robotics to make them more efficient in a global marketplace. So you'll see traditional industries listed, light assembly, manufacturing, plastics, metalworking. We have several textile companies that have located in this market in the last few years that are highly automated companies. You would put them on your traditional list, but they are advanced manufacturing. And so a lot more automation and a lot higher level of employee skill requirement to go into those operations. Logistics and distribution, I think it's pretty obvious with the highway network here, with the FedEx hub at the airport, with the other FedEx ground hub over just north of Kernersville, and then also what we have in terms of access to the ports. This is a great location to move product, particularly up and down the East Coast and to Europe. And so companies that come here have talked with us about accessing those opportunities. Office in downtown, there's a lot of office space now available in downtown. There's also a lot of suburban office space. So when I say office and downtown, it's really meant to talk about both initiatives in terms of office space throughout the community, as well as what could go in downtown to backfill some of the towers that have empty space. We still see an interest out of financial services, data centers, call center, and customer service. And when I'm talking about call centers, I'm talking about the ones that you call, not the ones that call you. So if you have a problem with your bank account, you have a problem with your investment account, your real estate or something like that, your credit card, you would call them. These are not folks that call you at dinner trying to sell you a timeshare or something like that. In the life sciences area, I think it's well known with our two major hospitals here and with what's going on in the Innovation Quarter. We have a real strong foothold in regenerative medicine, biotech, medical devices. Nanotechnology is a up and growing part of what Wake Forest is working on. And then just the continued growth of the whole hospital network throughout this region. Our Innovation Quarter, 200 plus acres in downtown. Back when it was started, the 25 to 30 year plan was pretty outstanding. It looked at several hundreds of millions of dollars of investment and 20 to 30,000 new jobs located in that market. Currently, there's about 42 companies that employ 900 people. There's a lot more moving there, obviously, and this slide has not been updated since Enmar moved in, and also with what the medical center is doing. But, there's a lot of key growth going on, the Winston-Salem Institute for Regenerative Medicine. And then there's a lot of build-out opportunity for headquarter recruitment and other types of production in the vacant sites that are located right in the heart of the park. And so I know that's a key strategy that Dr. Tomlinson's going to be working on, along with us and others, to try to bring opportunities to those sites. And then green industry, really twofold. You've got companies that operate green, which means they look for facilities that are green. They want to operate their facilities green. And then you look at companies that manufacture all of the products that go into making a facility green. And so we're looking at both sides of that equation. We like companies that want to be green and operate in a green environment and contribute that to our community. But we also like the companies that make the low flow valves and the toilets that have the bi-flush on it and the solar panel producers and the water barrel folks that put rain barrels together, those types of things as far as green industry and where that is headed. And we think there's a real strong upside in the future to that particular industry class. In marketing, and the things that you all help provide some money to our budget for every year, we do the traditional marketing things that most communities would do. We have call trips, advertisement. We do brochures, and our website's pretty robust, electronic newsletters and social media. For instance, some of our ads, we try to tout some of the growing companies that are in the marketplace. We talk about our labor force and our location along the coast, and these ads change all the time. So if this is one that that we might have run 6 months ago, we're currently revolving those to deal with the industry sectors that we're chasing and looking to place those in different areas where the companies that would read these might have an interest in doing business here. We have a demographics brochure that we put together every year that really just gives the nuts and bolts of the community, the population and the growth trends and all of the different costs of doing business here, the tax rates and the water rates, power rates, and all that kind of stuff. And all of this is online, by the way, if you want to log on to this website at some point in the future. It's wsbusinessinc.com, and all of our published materials are downloadable in PDF format because now everybody searches communities before they ever come look at them. We get eliminated a lot of times before we ever know that we're being looked at. And so trying to keep this up to date and make sure it is relevant to what our community has to offer is very, very important. Our investors were both publicly and privately funded. About three-quarters of our funding is private. The balance comes from the city and the county, mostly for marketing reimbursable, but our investors all get an electronic newsletter at least four times a year and when something significant happens. So if there's an announcement that comes out or if there is something unique going on that we need to communicate to our investors, we do that through this electronic newsletter, and it goes specifically to them. We also have an electronic newsletter that goes out to consultants, national real estate professionals, and our target businesses, and that's more focused on, you know, the cost of doing business here, sites and buildings, incentive opportunities, all the kinds of things that they would be looking at when they're evaluating a location. And you can find us on all the social media as well. One of the things that we get, I don't think gets enough traction, is we collaborate regionally with High Point, Greensboro, and Burlington, Alamance County. And we've been doing this for about 4 years now, where we have this regional brochure that kind of touts the same demographics that we have at the community level, but it's combined into one publication. And then this is translated into about 10 different languages and posted on the website. And it's a snapshot of what's going on in the region, primarily in the two or three major counties that make up the Piedmont Triad region. And it's been very well received. We had a German company in the other day, and we were able to give them this brochure in German. We had a Chinese textile company in. We handed them one in Chinese, and they were really thrilled to see a brochure about Winston-Salem and the Triad region in their own language. And so that was a very popular thing that we did. On the real estate side, we have on our website and through our office, we have not only a listing of online properties. So if you're in California and you're searching for an East Coast location, you can find facilities and sites that are available in this marketplace. Also, we work closely with developers and others to try to figure out how to reuse existing facilities, repurpose those, whether it's through brownfields, we have several opportunities there, or whether it's doing expansions, getting services to locations that don't currently have them, that type of thing. And of course, the Innovation Quarter is a great example of adaptive reuse of old facilities and turning them into opportunities. Whitaker Park would be another example of taking these older facilities that are currently underutilized and trying to repurpose those so that you don't tear something down and have to build something new. You can take what's already there. And then finally, identifying potential industrial sites going forward, which we have a lack of, and I'll touch on that as I move into challenges. We did a study about 2 years ago of the existing available industrial real estate in Winston-Salem and Forsyth County. And the results, I was very shocked. And there's a lot of space out there when you're looking around, but when you look at, is the space modern and does it meet the needs of modern manufacturing and distribution, you start to understand some of our challenges. And that is that only five of the buildings that we had on our list of buildings 2 years ago had ceiling heights 26 feet or greater. That sounds pretty high, but of the last 20 manufacturing or distribution RFPs that we got from companies looking for a location, they were expecting 28 feet clear or higher, which meant they would eliminate even 26 feet if you didn't meet that. And reminder, companies are trying to eliminate sites. They're not trying to select them. People think economic development is a site selection business, but it's really an elimination business. So you might be in initially, but if you don't meet the basic criteria, it's hard to keep moving forward in the process. Of these buildings, the average clear height was only 20 feet. Six had been built since 1990, and five of the buildings were expandable. So that meant that most of the buildings were old, with low ceilings, fully built out on their site, with no room to expand. And so that is a real challenge. And you can see from the chart the years things were built. The blue is 1940 to 59. The gold was 2000 to present. So most of our buildings are at least 20, 25 years old. In addition to that, we've had a fairly robust year the last two or three years. Out at the Union Cross area, over 2.75 million square feet of space was consumed since 2012. All of the buildings in red are now fully occupied and operational, and of course the building on the top left is the Odell facility, now occupied by Herbalife. So all of those buildings we were able to use as marketing tools to try to get companies to look at Winston-Salem, and none of those are available anymore. And I mentioned this to you when I came to talk about the need for a spec building. This has not changed. In fact, it's gotten worse, because now some of the other buildings that we did have in inventory have also been consumed, and so there's less space. And there's not much speculative development space being built. It's hard to get funding for that. It's hard to take the risk. And so there's really not a lot of product coming in and backfilling what's going on in the industrial space. There's been some discussion today about workforce, and workforce continues to be an interesting challenge. While the unemployment rate still remains somewhat high, companies that have specific skill set needs, when they take a look at a community, a lot of times they're having trouble finding those needs. For instance, in this community, I know it's been discussed, you know, IT is a fast-growing part of our community, but finding qualified IT workers is hard. Welding, nursing, some of the key employee types, Cytec's working hard to kind of backfill that opportunity. But, you know, that is a challenge, and it's not just here. It's all over the state. It's really all over the South. And so that's something that we all need to continue to work on, improving access to education opportunities for people so that they can get retrained and expanded into some of the more modern manufacturing opportunities that are out there. We've talked about incentives today. I'll tell you, I think we do a very good job on our incentives in Winston-Salem and Forsyth County. But right now, the state is still debating what they're going to do in terms of providing additional money for the JDIG program, which is the largest and most effective economic development program in the state. And so until the budget settles, we're not sure what's going to happen. July 1, there was $7.5 million in the JDIG fund, and by the end of July, that money was all accounted for. In other words, it was gone. And it has not been replenished, nor has the sunset in the next year and a half been extended. And so there's a lot of question in the minds of companies that are looking at North Carolina is, are we in the game, and do we want to compete for new business coming in? And that is a big flag and something we're all trying to help the state understand the importance of rational and legitimate incentives, which I think that program is. And you can look at what's going on in our surrounding states and see very clearly, that we're falling a little bit behind in terms of our competitiveness. There are opportunities, though, not just challenges. First opportunity, there is a new economic development organization in the state. It's called the Economic Development Partnership of North Carolina. It is both publicly and privately funded. And the idea is they pull the marketing and promotional and business recruiting side out of the old Commerce Department. They privatize it, and they are trying to staff it with the best talent and hold that talent accountable for their marketing and promotional and recruiting activities. And we're working very closely with this organization to make sure that a lot of our targets are included in their marketing opportunities. I was pleased to be asked to serve on an Economic Development Advisory Council for this organization, and we meet quarterly to talk about the strategy for moving the state forward. They're off and running, but they're behind. This organization took over 2 years to get put into place, and during that time, we lost a lot of momentum. There are several transformational projects I want to leave you with. You're aware of all of these, but I think it's important. There are some really cool projects out there in Winston-Salem that I think will help drive the future of this community. First is the old, we call it the Winston-Salem Business Site, but this was the extra 100 acres next to Odell. We purchased that and had full-blown analysis done. The site is certified by the state of North Carolina. It's a certified food site, which is also the highest level of certification that you can get. This site is currently under option to a developer. They're getting ready to grade a 178,000 square foot pad in anticipation of hopefully recruiting a company to do a build-to-suit on for that, and there's room for another almost million square feet of space on that site. So we're really excited. The biggest challenge is I need 10 of these. One is not enough, because if this site doesn't work, the opportunity moves on to something else. You can see here just a kind of a footprint of what's available. That bottom building, the smaller building, is the one that the footprint is being graded for right now. We did a site identification study last year. What we did was we wanted to look at the non-traditional areas. We worked very closely with Paul Norby's group. Derwick Page was very helpful with us in this regard as well. And we went out and looked at sites that aren't currently in the development plan, but that might be able to be added. For instance, they might not have sewer. They might not be right on the highway. There might be a zoning issue that needed to be taken care of. There might be a, you know, just something that kept it off of that original plan. And so we went and looked at areas along the corridor, some in Winston-Salem, some just outside. But the key point there was, were there large enough sites, 100 acres plus, that might be identified and brought into an area that we could rezone and make available? And we're still working through that study to try to figure out if what's there makes a lot of sense. That study would take the site such as this one, look at buildable areas on the site, look at hindrances such as abutting residential, lack of highway access, no sewer, things like that, and came back with a report of what they think could be developable out of a piece of property that was reviewed. So we did this for about six or eight sites throughout Forsyth County.
You don't have any of this under option or anything, do you?
No, we don't. We don't have any money to do that. If anything, what we'd hope to do is maybe drive some developers to those sites to say, here's an opportunity. We can help you maybe get the utilities there and get, you know, get the other upfit things that need to be done. And maybe through the bonds that were passed last year, there might be some monies available for that. But it's got to be the right site. Let me close with a couple other things. You know all about the spec building. You all are providing a loan for that. And we're well down the road in looking at talking with our contractors on this. And we hope to bring this to resolution by the end of August. Finally, the Whitaker Park is a unbelievably strong asset that RJ Reynolds is making available to this community. We have received the small building in the bottom right, the 630-2 building. That actually was transferred to the Whitaker Park Development Authority about 3 weeks ago. We have one company that has signed a lease to move in. Winston-Salem State is in the building now and continues to operate. So we should have two tenants in the building in September, and still we have about two-thirds of the building to lease. Most of that is lab space, and so we're marketing and promoting that through the state to targets that we have in that regard. And then the GMAC building. Interesting project there. There's a Charlotte developer who has the building under option, and he's going through his due diligence with an eye toward you know, what could be done with that property and also with the vacant lots that are adjacent to that property. And I think we'll hear more about that sometime in the next 60 days or so as some of the initial review is being accomplished. Lastly, the Innovation Quarter. That's a story really for this community to hang its hat on. This is an incredible asset for the community, taking the old production facilities from Reynolds and turning it into really state-of-the-art biotech lab space, office space, coupled with residential and the outdoor living space. This has really become a gem for downtown. There is a lot more land yet to be developed, a lot more opportunity. The challenge is we are running out of the available buildings that can be redone, and so now it's going to go to greenfield development, which typically is more expensive and more time-consuming, but still the opportunity is there. I think this is a real strong beacon for what's going on in downtown, and certainly is driving a whole lot of things. I did an hour-long presentation in about 22 minutes. I'm sorry that it took that long, but I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have, and I'm also happy to come back at any time and go into detail on any of these areas that you'd like.
Questions, comments?
Mr. Montgomery. I have two. One, in reference to the workforce, in discussion is about workforce. With the group of collaborators that are together and looking at the industries that we're focused on and trying to recruit to our community, and we talk about having and not having the individuals in the community at the time to be ready to go into certain jobs. My question always comes to that diversity in the recruiting of individuals that move into the jobs, just like the conversation that we had before here in finance. But that's always something that I hope is a part of a thought process when we're looking at and talking with companies about the diversity of the workforces that we're trying to make sure we're employing a diverse group of our community when individuals come in. That's first comment, more so and less of a question, I guess. The question would be, is that a part of the thought process?
Absolutely, and even more so now. I was involved with Mr. Page as we were working through the new incentive program, and you know what we were trying to get with that is to say, okay, companies, come in and hire people. If you happen to exceed certain classes of people that you hire, we were hoping they could come back for a bonus on top of that. So it puts the onus on them to hire the right people, to hire, you know, folks in categories that we as a community want to have hired. and then to come back and make proof of that to you all and say, look, we did what we said we'd do, we exceeded that, and so there would be a bonus opportunity. Obviously, we're still working to figure out how best to do that legally, but it's certainly an opportunity that we're looking at, and there's a lot of that discussion going on to make sure that we do that. All the companies I'm talking to are well aware of the desire of this community to have a diverse workforce hiring to operate that way, and so we are continuing to try to push that issue forward.
And the key point, I think, to understand is that being able to have an economy and a community where folk can get jobs that pay is one of the greatest opportunities that we can create in our environment. We spend less dollars on other social agencies and organizations if we can create a space where people can work and people want to work and people want to be able to be employed. And I think we have the folk in place to do that, but we have to continue to drive home because people want jobs, right. People want to work. And we end up spending on the other side because people don't have the jobs and they still need to make ends meet and they find other ways to do so. Other piece about the IT jobs, it was mentioned about that. And one question, I'm not sure how we integrate and what's been done, but I know, particularly from Winston-Salem State, that every one of my classmates who majored in some form of computer science or of something, every one of them, they had jobs before we graduated, right. Working for Duke, working for Altria, working for J.P. Morgan, working for folk all across the state and across the country. And so how are we working with institutions like that who have those type of programs to connect with these other folk who are in communities, like such as our NMARs and those and others who are looking for people who are trained in those type of curriculum?
Right. There are two different, there's a number of groups that work on that. Primarily the Northwest Piedmont Council of Governments through their job folks and also through Forsyth Tech really lead the hiring side of things. When we bring a company in and they want to talk about workforce, typically we make those introductions and then kind of step back because they're the ones that are training the people, looking at the workforce, seeing who's available, what the skill sets are of those folks, and also are doing some of the recruiting. They help put on the job fairs, they help promote the opportunities. And so, you know, I would encourage, you know, those groups to continue to make noise about what types of opportunities are available in the community now and the companies that they're working with look for. Because a lot of them are existing industries that are growing here. I'm not involved in that. That's another organization here in the community. But all of them are creating jobs. And so the groups that companies go to hire, both through the state and locally, I think those folks will do us all a service to continue to talk about the type of void that they're seeing in the market as they're trying to fill jobs. Because the companies go to them and say, hey, I need 10 IT people or 5 welders or whatever. And that's where we hear that they're having trouble getting that work done. You know, the state has a very strong program, and you know, it's run through the Department of Commerce. And you know, they have, you know, if you are registered, and that's another thing, you need to be registered so that you actually can hear about jobs that meet your skill set. But if you're registered, then you get notified when there's an opportunity, there's a job fair, there's a company that has certain requirements, and those are ways to continue to have that opportunity to interview for those jobs. So there's a lot of different sources out there to do that, and I think they just need to continue to promote what the opportunities are that are coming in. And when we're recruiting companies, you know, one of the things that we try to do is look at, you know, what type of skill sets this community is strong in, and then work to try to recruit those kinds of companies in as well. But remind you, there's a lot of communities out there trying to recruit the same companies, and it's a very, very competitive market.
Ms. Burke, you had.
Yes, I agree. It's a very, very competitive market, and I'm very pleased that Mr. Leek seems to understand, which he didn't in the beginning, how important it was for us to provide jobs for citizens directly in this city because we're using tax dollars. Mm-hmm. And to have all this unemployment and people walking the street, they're working poor as well as those not employed. And then we'll put in the incentives that we put in these with these companies. I think we should be very forceful. And when you brought up Mr. Mounds with NMAR, mm-hmm. I personally went to meet with him. And I was disappointed because he can show how much money that they have given to Wake Forest, but very little to Winston-Salem State University. And I have not talked with him in about 2 years, I think. And we even met with some people from the universities to try to make sure that these needs that they felt from these companies that you're bringing in, they will be able to provide job opportunities. So those of you on the council who have spoken clear and not been satisfied what you have seen, and I have said to the city manager, it's up to you and the staff that you have working here ought to be more aggressive. They need us. I know the competition is out there, but we have done an excellent job in providing incentives. Mm-hmm. We're one of the first cities that took the type of, I would say, decisions that we made. But then our taxpayers will tell us they don't see the results of job opportunities.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Bob.
Mm-hmm.
I am 35 minutes over. Mr. Brooks, we have the one item. Can that wait a month?
That's the man. Is that the man that had the problem last time? Have we done that one yet?
I don't think so.
Mr. Brimmer, we asked him to bring it back so you could see it.
That, yeah, that's the, Mr. that's what I'm asking.
Number six.
How was?
The problem is, Mr. Chairman, we're advertising for 6 o'clock, and I see public safety folks in the back who may be interested. So
I think we are have run our time, so we will just continue that to the next month. Okay? We will stand adjourned.
That has come around again, at least if we're going to delay it, to make sure that that's at the top of the agenda, at least.
Well, this is the first month it's been on the agenda.
Okay, I thought somebody said it came back.
And I think it was time since the end.
Yeah, council sent it back.
Yeah.
But it never came through here.
That's right. We didn't have committees last month. That's right.
Yeah, it did not come. It's never been through the committee. Yeah.
But, Mr. Chairman, I still want us to keep in mind that it was a lot weighing on this.
That's true.
And even in bringing it back a month from now, to me, we are still, I don't guess there's any way that we could review it, and then if we have questions before Monday.
Can we send it forward without a recommendation? Any questions could be handled before Monday. It was time sensitive at the council level.
Yeah, why don't we do that? Why don't we send it forward without a recommendation, and anyone that has any questions, please call Mr. Brooks between now and Monday night. How's that? Okay.
Well, then make sure, because that's the reason it came back, so we can...
We'll make sure there's plenty of supplemental information.
Okay. All right. Thank you. We're standing adjourned.